It's very fresh. It's amazing. But the Lord told me to really preach on how revelation comes. How revelation comes. Revelation meaning the unveiling, the revealing, and the Holy Spirit making alive things to your spirit that either you didn't know or you knew it, but not to the fullness that He's making it alive to you. And so I'm going to begin to share with you from Matthew chapter 16, and let's look at verse 13. So let's look at Matthew 16, and then we're going to look at verse 13. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Now I want to say this before I get a chance to get into this. If there's someone here that you're going to have to leave early and you did give the $200 amount, would you please let us know so that we can make sure. Okay, right over here on this side, I want to make sure that we get you these books. I want to give you the set that I have here. Those that have to leave early, and I know that they have to get to the airport, so I want to make sure you get these books, and I know you'll enjoy them and feed on them. Hallelujah. I love it when people actually read the material. Hallelujah. I love that. Something happens. They get transformed by it, right? And there are people that tell me they have almost everything I've got. Hallelujah. Isn't that wonderful? And they've actually read it?
Everything.
When they read it, something happens, right? Hallelujah. Okay, we're getting in the Word together. So go with me to Matthew. If you'll go with me to Matthew. Let's hit Matthew chapter 16 real quick. I want to just roll on this. I want to keep flowing and keep it going. And just release this to you. Matthew chapter 16. And we're going to begin, I believe, around verse 13. So Matthew chapter 16, and we'll begin, yes, exactly, verse 13. When Jesus came into the coast of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, "Who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am?" They said, "Some say that you're John the Baptist, some Elijah, others Jeremiah, or one of the prophets." He said to them, "But whom say ye that I am?" Simon Peter answered and said, "Thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God." And Jesus answered and said, "Blessed art thou, Simon Barjona, for flesh and blood hath not revealed it unto thee, but my Father which is in heaven. But I say unto thee that thou art Peter, and upon this rock I'll build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. And I will give unto thee the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, whatsoever thou shalt loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven." Now in this passage, as we begin to get in this, I want to show you that there's two revelations that's mentioned here. Two revelations, and one actually leads into the next one. If you don't get the revelation in this order, you cannot get the fullness of both of them. And the first revelation that came by the Holy Spirit was that Jesus was the Christ, the Son of the living God. And then notice what Jesus said, "Flesh and blood did not make that known unto you, Peter." Mm-hmm. Notice what Jesus was asking in the very beginning. "Whom do men say that I am?" Well, they say you're this prophet or you're that prophet, you're Isaiah, you're some great prophet, you know. And he said, "Well, okay, that's great that you're hearing what other people say that I am, but whom do you say that I am?" Now, that's the big question, by the way. Did you know that question alone will determine whether you make heaven or don't make heaven? Mm-hmm. The confession that Jesus is Christ, the Son of God, mm-hmm. makes all the difference.
Amen.
And it's interesting, too, that he said, "Whom do you say that I am?" He said, "Thou art the Christ." The word Christ is the Greek word Christos, the anointed one and his anointing. It also means the Messiah, the chosen one, and the one that is the only way to heaven. That's what it means. Okay? So thou art the Christ. You are the Messiah. You are the chosen one. You're the Holy One of God. You're the only way to heaven. And then Jesus said, "You know, flesh and blood didn't reveal it to you." In other words, what he's saying is, "My Father, you got this by revelation. You got this by the Spirit of God sent from the Heavenly Father." Isn't that wonderful? And then, notice, once he got that revelation of who Jesus was, Jesus then gave him the next revelation, which was who Peter was. See, you'll never know who you are till you know who God is.
Amen.
Yes. Many people go around and say, "I'm just trying to find myself." Well, if you'd find God, you'd find yourself. Because our life is hid with Christ in God.
Okay.
You'll never find yourself outside of God. You find yourself in God. Boy, someone needs to hear that.
Amen.
You never find yourself outside of God. You'll always find yourself in God. In Him we live. In Him we move. In Him we have our being. When you find who God is and who you are in Him, you find yourself.
That's it.
That's where the revelation of who you are and why you're here and what you're supposed to do comes from.
Yes.
It's come from knowing who God is and who you are in God. Boy, take hold of that. Let that minister to you for a moment. And he said, you are Peter. You are Peter. You are you are Petros. That's the word Peter. Petros. Petros means a little rock or a chip off the big rock.
Chip off the
old rock. There's no one older than God. So chip off the old rock, right?
Yeah.
And then he said, and upon this rock, Petra himself. God is our rock, right?
Yes.
Upon Petra, that's how the church is built. Church was never built on Peter.
That's right.
Because he was just a little piece of rock. He wasn't a solid foundation. Check out his life. He was not a solid foundation.
Yeah.
Amen. But Jesus is the Petra, the solid foundation. He said, upon the rock of who I am. In fact, the revelation of who I am, like you just spoke, I will build my church and the gates of hell cannot prevail against it. And because you have that revelation now, I'm going to give you the keys, those are keys of authority. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt bind on earth shall be bound in heaven, and whatsoever thou shalt loose on earth shall be loosed in heaven. The Lord gave me a revelation of that too. Get this. What we bind on earth, He binds in the heavens. He waits for us. But remember the prayer that He taught His disciples to pray. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it already is in heaven. In other words, we're supposed to look into the heavens. We're supposed to have some spiritual sight here.
Yes.
And revelation of how is it in heaven. Well, in heaven, is there any sickness?
No.
Well, then we're going to have to bind sickness here because, listen, there's no sickness up there. So there's not supposed to be any sickness here.
Yes.
Total health and healing there. So we're going to loose that here. So we find out what is it like in heaven, and we bind and loose accordingly.
Amen.
And the Lord says this. He said, if you'll do it, how many knows there's three heavens?
Yes.
There's an atmospheric heaven that's around the earth.
Mm-hmm.
And by the way, demon spirits can inhabit that realm.
Yeah.
Angels too, by the way.
Yeah.
Then you have the second heaven. The second heaven is where the demonic realm really works, right?
Yes.
Big time. The third heaven, only God and His angels can inhabit that realm.
Amen.
Right? So there's three realms. So get this. What I bind on earth, get this, God from the heavens binds, get this, binds the heaven under Him.
Yes.
So whenever I bind sickness, God in the heavens starts speaking and says, it shall be so as they said it. And it operates in both the second and the first heaven.
Yes.
Because we set it on the earth.
Hallelujah.
And I lose healing and miracles. Then the Father in heaven says, there shall be healing and miracles from the second heaven all the way to the earth.
Yes.
What you bind on earth is bound in heaven. In other words, when you bind it, He binds it.
Yes.
When you loose it, He looses it.
Yes, sir.
But He's waiting for us to do it.
Amen.
Boy, how many catching this?
Yes.
Come on, He's waiting for you to do it.
Amen.
He's waiting for you to do something because He gave you the keys. Get this. If He gave you the keys, you're the one to lock and unlock.
Yes.
Yeah, that's right.
Amen.
I want to say this, it's amazing. Several years ago, my wife and I, we were coming back from, I think we pastored a church at the time, and we came back from a meeting late at night, and I had some books and Bibles in my hand, and I really thought my wife had the keys to the front door. Okay. And back then, we didn't have a garage. We just parked the car out by the house, you know. And so it was kind of dark, and it was coming up. And I said to my wife, as I was holding these Bibles, I said, huh, unlock the door. She said, I can't unlock the door, baby, because I gave you the keys. I said, no, I don't have the keys. You have the keys. And we kind of went back and forth. How many understands that? And finally, I was going, please, honey, I'm carrying all these heavy books and Bibles. I need you to. And she said, baby, check your pockets. And I thought, I'm going to prove her wrong. I'm going to prove her wrong. So I stuck my hand in my pocket, and there were the keys. How many realizes, as much as I would have wanted her to unlock the door, she couldn't.
That's right.
Do you know why she couldn't? She didn't have the keys. I did. Jesus gave the keys to us. He doesn't even have them anymore. He doesn't have the keys on the earth. He has the keys in the heavens to do the heavenly realm. We have the keys to do the work on the earth. We have to buy. Oh, come on, somebody. So there are things, get this, there are things we're asking God to do He can't do.
Amen.
Wow. I remember listening to Bill Johnson talk about that. He said, you know, some of y'all are wasting your prayer energy. Wearing yourself out, praying prayers that God can't answer.
Well,
get this, I'm begging God to heal me, but He did it 2,000 years ago. He cannot answer that prayer.
It's already done.
It's us receiving it. It's also us kicking devil booty.
All right now.
Come on, somebody.
Amen.
Because sickness is a spirit.
Yes, ma'am.
It's a
spirit. Poverty is a spirit. Lack is a spirit. Depression is a spirit. Even pain is a spirit.
Yep.
And we're asking Him to do something He can't even do. So what are we doing? We're wasting our time. And we're going to get real upset with God. God, why aren't you doing this? And God is saying, I did it. I did it. When are you going to find out who you are? Rise up and take authority and begin to move in high level. Listen, the higher the level of authority you operate in, the more you'll see the manifestations of God you desire.
That's it.
But you cannot operate high levels of authority with low levels of revelation.
Yeah, true.
You cannot operate at high levels of authority with low levels of revelation. Mm-hmm. Revelation means the unveiling of the Word. Also, the level of your submission to godly authority will also determine the level of authority you'll operate in.
Mm-hmm.
And we see that from Matthew chapter 8 with the centurion coming to Jesus and said, Jesus, you don't even have to come to my house.
Hallelujah.
All you have to do is speak the word because, and he said, because I understand. I am a man under authority. Here's the word, under authority, submitted to authority. And because I'm submitted to authority, then people have to submit to me. I have people under me. So that I say to one, go, and he goes, another stay, and he stays, has to obey my words. Because I'm submitted to authority. Jesus said, I'm amazed. I've never seen such greater faith. In a totally different dimension of faith, Jesus said. Amen. In all of Israel, there's no one with the faith you have. You're operating in a high level, a very high level of authority because of your revelation of authority. Mm. Therefore, your faith is also very great.
Come on.
I want to say this to you. Your understanding and your revelation of authority and how to operate in it and how you submit to authority. So you don't have to submit to everybody. You have to submit to somebody.
Mm-hmm.
There needs to be some really godly people in your life that you can take counsel from, that you can have, something they can pray for you, that when they give you a word of instruction or correction or whatever, you receive instead of getting mad.
Amen.
Then that authority that they have comes to you.
Yes.
The authority you submit to is the authority you will operate in. And you don't have to submit to everybody, you got to submit to somebody.
Right.
You understand what I'm saying right now?
Yes.
And when you understand that, get this, when you understand authority, you'll stand under authority and you'll operate in authority.
Amen.
Walking, yes, sir.
But you have to understand it to stand under it.
Amen.
You cannot if you don't understand it. Understanding means revelation. You need a revelation. Authority does not make you less and does not take away from who you are.
Amen.
Right.
That's good.
Well, I'm going to lose my... You know, in America, we have what we call an independent spirit. It's a spirit of Satan. It's not the spirit of Christ.
Right.
Freedom is a spirit of Christ.
Amen.
An independent spirit is a prideful spirit that's of Satan.
Right.
And it will keep you from submitting to authority. You'll think that, I'm going to have it my way. Y'all go ahead and do all that.
Come on.
But you'll only have your authority.
Right.
You'll never have a greater authority.
Amen.
Which means You're not going to get rid of the big devils.
Woo! That's it.
You're only going to kick devil butt when the little ones.
Right.
Yeah. The little ones.
Yeah.
The big ones show up and you're in trouble because you hadn't submitted to anybody. Well, I better move on.
Oh, no, stay right there.
Better move on. Some of you are facing some big, hairy, mean demons and principalities. You will never overcome it by yourself.
Amen.
You can bind, rebuke, fast, pray, do whatever you want. But if you're not submitting to anybody, you'll never have a level of authority you need to overcome that thing.
Right.
One can chase 1,000, two can chase 10,000. Get this. One can only chase 1,000. One cannot chase 10,000. One can only chase 1,000. But you start submitting to other people and you start joining with other people. That's why I'm always having people pray for me. That's why I have men and women of God over me that I submit to, that I love, that I cherish, that I listen to for counsel and guidance.
Amen.
I will receive correction from them. I will receive instruction from them. Therefore, I operate at a higher level of authority because of it. They do not diminish who I am. They multiply who I am.
Amen.
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 And listen, don't ever submit to somebody that controls you, but correction is not control.
Right.
There are some real apostles and prophets that actually will love you and encourage you. There's some pastors that will love you and encourage you. And yes, they will correct you. But correction, instruction is not a bad word.
No.
Correction instruction breeds righteousness. Correction instruction breeds that peaceable fruit of righteousness and a blessing. It will cause you to be blessed.
Amen.
Connect with people. Listen, connect with people that would lay their life down for you. That's how you know they're the right ones. They would die for you if necessary. Come on, somebody.
Amen. That's a good word.
And there are some of those around, by the way.
Amen.
Amen. Not every leader is a dictator. There are a few. Run from those.
Right.
Amen. Amen. But there's some real people that love you dearly, that will help you, that will instruct you, that will speak into your life, that would pray for you all hours of the day and night, and would care for your soul. Those are the ones you can literally, you know, you can submit to and say, yes, ma'am, or yes, sir, to, and receive that. I had an apostle that loved me dearly. I could call him many hours of the day and night. But boy, did he correct me. He would correct me sometimes so hard, but he would start crying.
Oh, wow.
He'd start bawling while he's correcting me. And you know what I learned to say to him? Yes, sir. I take it. I receive it. I'm going to do something about it. I'd cry with him. We'd both sit there and cry. More than once, he said, there's some danger areas, Phil. Watch out. So I had to watch out. I said, yes, sir, I will. I will. Thank you so much for loving me enough to point it out. You know what he always told me? Everybody has a blind spot.
Amen. Amen.
Come on.
Everybody. So you got to have somebody to help you see the blind spot.
Right, right.
Yes.
Boy, we better keep moving. How he's catching some revelation.
Yeah.
Life-changing revelation. Amen. I'm going to take you now to Deuteronomy 29:29, just a little bit more of understanding. And Deuteronomy 29:29, that should be pretty easy to understand, at least to remember anyway. 29:29, right? If you look at Deuteronomy 29:29, and this is a verse that God gave me that really opened my eyes to things about revelation. Why do I need revelation? That was my question. Why do I need revelation? Why do things need to be revealed to me, right? What's the big thing with revelation? Right? Until this verse, it cracked it open. Deuteronomy 29:29. The secret things belong to the Lord our God. But those things which are revealed belong to us and to our children forever, that we may do all the words of this law. So we said, what's revealed is your property. What isn't revealed, you can't have it. Even though it may be for you. Even though it may be yours. So what you don't know, what you don't have revealed is hurting you. But notice what else? Not only is it yours, but it tells you that the revelation brings the motivation.
All right.
As well as the manifestation, but it brings the motivation to do the word. He said that we may do all the words of this law. So the Lord showed me this. Whatever you don't have a revelation of, you don't have the motivation to do.
Whoa.
So you can't do it even though you know it.
Wow.
You can have a head knowledge about prayer but not have a heart revelation, and you'll have the hardest time praying. But you get a real revelation. That means we need fresh revelations, right?
Yes.
You get a fresh revelation of prayer and intercession and the power of it.
Yes.
I'll tell you, honey, you're going to be so motivated you can't quit praying.
Yes.
I just released something right there.
Yes.
You won't be able to stop praying.
Amen.
You're going to be praying all the time. Isn't that wonderful?
Jesus.
You get a revelation of seed time and harvest and how God really wants to bless you. And boy, an offering comes, you're going to be the first person to give. And you're going to give generously without even thinking about it. And you cannot be offended. Offense come because of lack of revelation.
Amen.
You'll never be offended by what's revealed to you. That's good, isn't it? Hallelujah. Get this. What's revealed is always what's healed. Revelation begets manifestation. But it also brings motivation. Isn't that beautiful? I've been catching that. I've been beginning to see that perhaps we need some revelation, right?
Amen.
I'm going to begin to give you five ways to see that the spirit of revelation and revelation increased in your life. How many wants to know what those are?
Yes.
Here's the first one. It's really based on relationship. Did you know if you're not willing to build a close, intimate relationship with God, He will not reveal more things to you?
Amen.
Many people are saying, God, I want you to do big things for me. In fact, some people's prayer life, you know, kind of sounds like, give me this, give me that, give me something else.
That's true.
Right? And I got to thinking about that. If the only time my children ever wanted to talk to me and ever wanted to be with me was when they wanted something, I would not appreciate that very much. And it wouldn't make me feel like they loved me. Well, somebody needs to hear what I'm saying. So perhaps, and I will say this to you, perhaps we're not going about this thing right. We're not wanting to build our relationship first, and out of a relationship comes every need supplied. I remember several years ago, our oldest granddaughter, she's 16, she just turned 16 on the 18th of this month. That's our oldest granddaughter. And I remember she was 5 years old, and I was reading, I don't know if I was reading one of my books or something, you know, or a book that somebody had written. I was reading. I'm always reading and studying. And so I'm having this book, and she crawls up underneath, because I'm sitting in my big chair. She crawls up underneath the book. So I go ahead and put the book down. She takes my face in her hands.
Yes.
And turns my face till we are nose to nose.
Yes.
And she says, Papa, don't you know I love you?
Oh.
Wow. She wasn't asking me for anything.
Yeah. Yeah.
I was reaching for my wallet saying, baby, is there anything Papa can get for you? First Samuel chapter 3. I want you to see this right out of the Word of God. Once we see it out of the Word of God, we'll get it, right?
Amen.
First Samuel chapter 3. I'm going to begin with verse 1 and go through verse 7. The child Samuel ministered of the Lord before Eli, and the Word of the Lord was precious in those days. The word precious meant that it was like a diamond or a ruby. There's not a lot of them. That's why it's precious.
Mm-hmm.
That's what the word meant, scarce. Precious means scarce. The word of the Lord was very scarce. It wasn't happening a lot in those days, and there was no open vision. Now I'm going to make a connection between these two.
Mm-hmm.
Where there's lack of revelation, there's lack of vision.
Yeah.
People can't see in the spirit. People can't see what God wants them to see. We're all blind without revelation.
Mm-hmm.
Then verse 2, it came to pass at that time that Eli was laid down in the place, and his eyes began to wax dim, and he could not see. Now, he actually became physically blind, but not until he first became spiritually blind.
Mm-hmm. That's it.
Study about Eli.
Yes.
He became spiritually blind first.
Yes.
And then his natural eyes began to become blind.
Yeah.
And it said, and ere the lamp of God was out of the temple of the Lord, where the ark of God was, and Samuel laid down to sleep. It's interesting, Samuel laid down to sleep next to the ark.
Mm-hmm.
And then it said that the Lord called Samuel. He said, here am I. He ran to Eli and said, "Here am I, if thou callest me." And he said, "I called you not. Lay down." And he went back and laid down. The Lord called yet again, "Samuel, Samuel." He rose and went to Eli, said, "Here am I, for thou hast called me." He answered and he said, "I called you not, my son. Lie down again." And look at this, in verse 7. Now Samuel did not yet know the Lord.
Okay.
He was sleeping next to the ark. You can be aware of the presence of God and not know the person of God.
Wow.
Woo.
That's good.
Wow. You can come to the house of God and be involved in praise and worship.
Yes.
And know the presence of God but not know the person of God.
Amen.
And Samuel did not yet know the Lord. Look at this. Neither was the word of the Lord yet revealed unto him.
Okay.
You want to tap into revelation? Start building a relationship.
Yes.
An intimate relationship with God. Start loving Jesus. Start talking to the Lord Jesus. Start pouring your heart out to him. When you read the word, read it with him in mind. When you pray, pray with him in mind.
Yes.
Come on, somebody.
Yes. Yes.
It's all about relationship.
That's it.
Praise God.
Yes.
And because of that relationship will come revelation power.
Yes.
He'll make known himself unto you.
Yes.
I remember in James where it says, "Draw nigh to me, then I'll draw nigh to you."
Yeah.
So it's something we got to do first. You know why? Because he already did the first move.
Amen.
He went to the cross. He said, "I love you so much. This is how much," and he died.
Yeah.
He made the first move. Now it's our move.
Amen.
Well, I want God to do all this. Well, he already did all this. What are you doing now? Are you responding to relationship? Ooh, turn to someone and say, "I'm going to build a closer relationship with God. I'm going to start actually talking to Jesus as my beloved." I'm a Jesus person, okay? And so you got to catch this. You got to catch this. Even if you want to talk to the Father, Jesus said, you got to come through my name. When I'm praying in tongues, see, a lot of people don't understand this. Do you know who it was that paid for your salvation? Who?
Jesus
did. Okay? Do you know who it was? Who it was that was born of a Virgin Mary and came to this earth in order to pay for our salvation?
Jesus.
Do you know who's going to come after his people one day?
Jesus.
Mm. Do you know who the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords is?
Jesus.
Do you know who the Alpha and Omega is?
Jesus.
Who's the beginning and the end?
Jesus.
Who's the first and last?
Jesus.
Who's the Lamb that was slain?
Jesus.
Who's the coming King?
Jesus.
So I guess we need to be in love with Jesus.
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
That does not take away from the Father. And it doesn't take away from the Holy Spirit, because the Bible says in John 14, 15, and 16, those three chapters, when the Holy Spirit comes, he's not going to speak of himself, he's going to speak of me.
Yes.
Amen.
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 Even the Holy Spirit is going to be talking to everybody about Jesus.
Yes.
Amen.
You know, I like to talk a lot about Jesus, and a lot of people won't talk about God, but you know, which God are you talking about?
Right.
You talk about Jesus Christ, you have cut through the quick. Come on, somebody.
Yeah.
You got to the main issue.
Yeah.
What is the main issue? Say, Jesus.
Jesus.
Jesus is the main issue.
Jesus
is the main issue. Okay? Now, here's the second thing I want you to get, and that's found in Isaiah 53:1. I want you to catch this. This is a verse the Lord just unveiled it to me. So go with me to Isaiah. How many loves the book of Isaiah?
Oh, yeah.
Man, I love the book of Isaiah. That book is one of my favorites. Hallelujah. I guess they all are, but I really love Isaiah. And the older I get, the more I love Isaiah.
Oh, yeah.
Something happens to me when I get in the book of Isaiah.
Yeah.
Look at verse 1 of 53. Isaiah 53:1.
Mm-hmm.
Who hath believed our report? And to whom is the arm of the Lord revealed? Now the arm of the Lord, that means the muscle of God that does something in our behalf. And you go down and read what it is. For he was wounded for our transgressions. He was bruised for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him. And with his stripes we're healed. Wow. That's the strong arm of the Lord. How is he? Listen, if he reveals to you his strong arm, you know what's going to happen? You're going to be healed. You're going to be saved. You're going to be delivered. You're going to prosper. Every bondage is broken. Every demon is chased away. Come on. That's what happens when the strong arm of the Lord shows up. Come on. He's the muscle. And he's coming down with the lightning fist. Isaiah 30. He's coming down with his lightning fist. Destroying principalities and powers. Woo. Glory. Hallelujah. So when the strong arm of the Lord is revealed, miracles happen.
Yes.
Amen.
Amen? Amen.
And how does that happen? To my life and situation. We can just keep on going, but we'll quit. Now, here's number three. Prayerfully seeking increases the power of revelation and brings revelation into your life. In Daniel chapter 2, go over to Daniel. Let's go to Daniel together. And we're going to look at Daniel chapter 2. Hallelujah. Oh, praise God. How many's getting something good out of it?
Yes.
Daniel chapter 2, and let's look at verse 19. Now, this is an amazing verse here, really. In fact, can we back up to 16 and move into 19? I think that'll be better. Then Daniel went in and desired of the king that he would give him time, that he would show the king, that he would show the king the interpretation, and that Daniel would reveal the interpretation to the king. And Daniel went to his house and made the thing known to Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah, which was Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. This is their Hebrew names, by the way. Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego is not their Hebrew names. Those are the Persian names, okay? That they would desire mercy. So he went to the three Hebrew children, Daniel did, and they all prayed together and sought the face of God basically all night long in order to gain revelation. Don't be in a hurry if you want revelation. If you want God to show you something you don't know, don't be in a hurry.
Amen.
Amen.
Takes time. And that they would desire mercies of the God of heaven concerning the secret that Daniel and his fellows should not perish with the rest of the wise men of Babylon. Then was the secret revealed unto Daniel in a night vision. Then Daniel blessed the God of heaven after they sought the Lord. And you know what's amazing? Sometimes you're going to need to join with somebody else and have someone actually pray with you.
Amen.
We need each other, really.
Amen.
More than you'll ever know.
Amen.
You need one another.
Amen.
And I found out usually someone else is part of your key, part of your deliverance, part of your healing, part of your freedom.
Yes.
You don't necessarily have to have a million people praying for you. The Bible says if any two of you shall agree. But you definitely want somebody that can harmonize. The word agreement means to harmonize in the spirit.
Yeah.
The same key, the same song,
yeah,
the same beat,
yes,
at the same time,
yes,
singing the same words.
That's, right.
That's the word agree.
That's
agree. Amen.
Yes.
And it'd be kind of like, you know, having a big band or an orchestra. And, you know, all of a sudden, have you ever noticed when they're all warming up?
Mm-hmm.
Man, it sounded like a lot of noise,
not
right?
Like, clanging,
clanging. Yeah, it don't make any sense to me. And it's like, oh, that's horrible, right? But as soon as the conductor starts, he uses a little baton,
and
click, 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 and everyone gets quiet.
Yeah.
And then he comes up with his hands, and they're all up with their instruments.
Yeah.
And then when he comes down on the beat, at the same time, in the same key, the same song, come on, they start. And then all of a sudden, it's such a beautiful harmony. Let me notice that.
Yes.
It's such a glorious harmony. And it's beautiful. And see, God wants us to come to the place to where we can harmonize together. And we can begin to make beautiful music in the spirit realm that brings the glory of God and the fullness of God. Did you know your prayer is like music to God?
Hallelujah.
Yes.
People don't know that. And particularly when you have people praying together. You know, there's several types of prayer, and we need to have all of them in our life. You need to have a devotional prayer. I'm going to quickly give this to you, different types of prayer. The three of the most important. I'm going to give you three most important, okay? I may actually hit four, okay? I'll hit four. Here's the number one most important type of prayer, and that's devotional prayer. That's where it's you and God. Psalms 5 pulls that up. Psalms 5 pulls that up, devotional prayer. Jesus did it in Mark 1:35, where he went out a great while before today, and there he prayed, and he fellowship with the Father, with the Spirit. So it's important that we have devotional prayer. Your devotional prayer is the foundation of all prayer. If you don't get devotional prayer right, nothing else works in your prayer. Nothing else works. So all prayer has to be based on devotional prayer. Then the next type of prayer is called basically called corporate prayer, where you pray together. You know, I did a study, and I would love to preach that message sometime, and I have in different places, but I haven't had a chance to preach it here as far as I know. But the thing called corporate prayer, and I went through the whole Bible, and every place where God's people prayed together, great power, great deliverance, and great breakthrough took place. But it was praying together, okay? So you have your devotional prayer, you have your corporate prayer. Here's another one. The prayer of agreement, where you actually harmonize with people. If any two of you shall agree as touching anything you ask, it shall be done of my Father which is in heaven, right? Okay, so it's that agreement prayer. And here's another one. I'm going to go ahead and throw it in. Prayer in tongues. I'm going to throw that in.
Yes.
You know, Jude 20, building up yourself in your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost. We need to be praying in the Spirit. That's also Romans chapter 8, verse 26, 27, and 28. Hallelujah. And then 1 Corinthians chapter 14, verse 14 and 15. Hallelujah. There's many, many others, but we'll stop with that. So our prayerful seeking of God will increase the revelatory realm, okay? Now go to 1 Corinthians chapter 2. I'm going to show you something else. And this is the one I didn't mention a moment ago. But your prayer in tongues increases revelatory anointing in your life. Most people, can I say this to you? Most people don't pray in tongues enough.
I know, that's right.
I pray in tongues a lot. I still don't pray in tongues enough.
I do too.
You know, and I'm doing it all the time. But I do remember, you know, I remember a day, and God, you know, and only grace can do this, okay? I really believe if you're able to pray a whole lot, you have hit a level of grace.
Yeah.
Yeah.
How many listening to me?
Amen.
Because you can't do it without grace. There was a man that I know that he is a prophetic intercessor. He's a prophet of God, and he intercedes many hours a day, sometimes all night long. And he always prays hours and hours and hours. In fact, he's been to our World Missions Conference before, Prophet Bill Norton. Some of you remember Prophet Bill Norton. Anyway, Prophet Bill Norton, he could pray a lot of hours. And he was going to this church, and this pastor was saying, he said, "Man, I'm having a hard time praying." And Bill said, "I'm not. I can pray many hours a day." He said, for the next 3 days, he said, "I couldn't pray." I said, "God, what's wrong? I can usually pray hours." The Lord said, "I'm going to teach you a lesson. Without my grace, you can't pray."
Yeah.
Okay.
So he said, "Lord, forgive me for my arrogance and help me to pray for this pastor and encourage this pastor and pray for more grace in this man's life." He said, when he repented, he said he could pray again many hours a day.
Wow.
So if you're struggling with prayer, don't beat yourself up. Ask God for more grace.
Amen.
And push into the... Oh, how do I so careful? For it is not your ability that causes the blessing to come. It is what I have done. It is my ability and my grace. If you press into me and press into my grace, you will have an ability beyond your own, and nothing will be impossible unto you. I will empower you. I will equip you in my grace.
Yes.
Ooh, somebody rejoice.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
Jesus.
Some things I'm gonna have to go ahead and speak it in tongues first.
Yes.
And then just interpret it.
Yes.
Because I didn't even have the words for what I wanted to say.
Yes.
Well, that's tongues and interpretation, so I said it the way the Lord wanted it to say it. Hallelujah. 1 Corinthians 2, how many's already there? And I want to show you, let's begin at verse 9 real quick here. "But as it is written, I have not seen nor ear heard, neither has it entered the heart of man, the things which God has prepared for those that love him." But God hath revealed them unto us by His Spirit.
Wow.
In other words, for years people would take verse 9 and talk about heaven. But that's really not in the context at all.
No.
Right.
Okay. Even though I believe that's true about heaven, right. It's greater than we could ever imagine.
Right.
It.
Right.
That's really not the context of that verse. The context of that verse is all about God revealing things to us.
Yes.
That's ours.
Jesus.
So we can have it.
Yes.
Remember the secret things belong to the Lord, but yes. Things that are revealed belong to us. That's the meaning of chapter 2.
Yes.
Isn't that beautiful? But God has revealed them unto us by His Spirit. For the Spirit searcheth all things, yea, the deep things of God. For what man knows the things of a man, save the spirit of man which is in him? Even so the things of God knoweth no man but the Spirit of God. Now we receive not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit of God, that we might know or have revealed to us the things that's freely given to us by God. In other words, there's things freely given to us by God that we don't yet have a revelation of, therefore we have no manifestation of.
Wow.
But when it's revealed to us by the Spirit, then we can have the manifestation and the motivation.
Good.
Look at verse 13. Which things also we speak, not in the words which man's wisdom teaches, but which the Holy Ghost teaches, compare spiritual things with spiritual. That's tongues.
Wow.
Verse 13 is talking about tongues.
Yes.
We need to pray a lot in tongues.
Yes.
Right?
Right.
Yes.
Now, years ago, I remember listening to Brother Hagin. How many's ever listened to Kenneth Hagin?
Yes.
I was listening to Kenneth Hagin. He was talking about the different breakthroughs at different levels of prayer. He said usually an hour of prayer, you'll get a certain amount of revelation. He said sometimes after 3 hours, something begins to happen. He said when you hit 5.5 hours of solid prayer in tongues, he said something breaks open in the spirit realm that you have never experienced in your life.
Right.
New realms open in 5.5 hours. And I can tell you it is true.
Yes.
What?
It is true.
It is true.
There are things that are open. The more you pray in tongues, and it's almost like you have to break through stuff by praying in tongues.
Yeah. Okay.
You have to come through stuff. And you know one of the greatest things you got to come through is our own flesh. Our flesh is so time conscious, and our flesh is wanting to rest, and our flesh is wanting to do stuff, and our flesh is wanting to eat, our flesh is wanting to be entertained, our flesh is wanting, you know, and it's an enmity against God. It keeps us from being spiritual. We're so fleshly, we're struggling to even be spiritual. That's why if you can keep praying in tongues when your mind's going, you don't even know what you're saying. Well, it don't even make any sense. See, you're hearing all that junk in the spirit realm.
Right.
So Satan will use your flesh, and the demons are talking to you, and the devils don't want you to get a breakthrough.
Oh, yeah.
So they want you to stop praying in tongues. And you know, all of a sudden, your mind can remember everything you should be doing for the next 3 years.
That's true.
And I learned something. Get you a notebook on things I need to do, write it, things I need to do when you take it into your prayer time. And when all of a sudden, the enemy's releasing your memory on everything you need to do to stop you from praying, take that prayer list and keep praying in tongues and write all those things down. And then set it aside. Say, shut up, devil, and keep going in tongues.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Amen.
And then have a path, things revealed. And keep praying in tongues while things are revealed. Don't stop. Keep praying in tongues and write them down.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Praise God. Woo. Woo. And I tell you what, things will happen like, in fact, I'll tell you what happened one time. This happened probably maybe 20 years ago. And we were pastoring a church out in West Texas, Lockney, Texas. Way out there, I think, was it Plainview, Texas? Is that where it was, near Plainview, Amarillo, out of that area? Anyway, we were out there. And pastoring this church, and I remember a Sunday night after service, about 10 o'clock, and I laid down. When I laid down, I felt a prayer burden. How many's ever had a prayer burden come on you?
Yeah.
You just knew you're supposed to pray, right?
Yeah.
So I just started praying in tongues, and my wife folded both of us, and I got caught up in praying. How many's ever got caught up in praying in tongues in time? You don't even know about time.
Yeah.
It's that eternal thing, say, eternal time. You'll hit a realm called eternal time. And I started praying in tongues, and I hit a realm called eternal time, and I thought it was 5 minutes. But I looked over and it was 2 hours.
Jesus.
It was 2 hours. And then it lifted. How many's ever had it come and then had it lift?
Yep.
So you go through waves in the spirit realm. And so it kind of lifted. And I said to the Holy Spirit, I said, what was that? Who was I praying for? And what was I praying for? And as soon as I said it, I had these flash visions in my mind's eye. How many's ever had flash vision?
Yeah.
Just, and I had this flash vision. I saw a lady pastor from DeSoto, Texas, where I preached in her church. I saw her face. And then here's another flash vision. I saw a picture of the outside of the church. And all of a sudden I felt peace. And I knew everything's all right with her. Everything's all right with the church. So it's sleep. Well, this is Sunday night. By Wednesday night, my curiosity was getting the best of me. So I hadn't talked to this woman in many years. We got busy, she got busy, and we loved each other. We just went different directions. So I pick up the phone, and I call her. And I say to her, I said, listen, on Sunday night, I come in under a prayer burden and prayed for 2 hours, and I asked the Holy Spirit who I was praying for. I saw a flash vision in my mind's eye of your face and of the church. I said, what is going on? She said, well, she said, we have a balloon payment on our church. That, and this, I remember this is Wednesday when I'm talking to her, that if we don't come up with a balloon payment by Friday, we lose the building. We're going to lose the whole building. And I said, well, that's not going to happen. Remember how I felt the breakthrough? Mm-hmm. And I said, well, what about you? She said, well, they say that I something has happened to my throat that I can never preach again, that I'm going to have to stop preaching. And she said, I'd rather die than quit preaching. I said, you're not going to quit preaching. You're not going to have to. Healing's coming to your throat.
Yes.
Amen. I mean, there was such a condition, they said, you cannot preach anymore. You cannot preach anymore. Well, you know what? I just gave her the good news, what I believe God was going to do for her. And then I didn't hear from her for another year. Okay. And so I pick up the phone and I call her and said, hey, how you been doing and how the church been doing? She said, we're doing great. She said, I'm completely healed. I've been preaching like crazy.
Yeah. Hallelujah.
Completely healed. I said, what about the church? It's paid for. Well, oh, someone should have shouted on that.
Hallelujah.
Not just balloon payment, it's paid for.
Amen.
So there's realms of breakthrough in tongues where God reveals things to you.
Yes.
Shows things to you. Sometimes, you know, how many love to get more words of knowledge and get more detail from the Holy Spirit?
Yes.
You just don't pray enough in tongues.
That's right.
And I remember many times while I'm praying in tongues, I'll be praying in tongues for a length of time, and all of a sudden, here comes a name will come to me. And then I wait a little moment, and a need comes to me. I know it's connected the two, name and a need.
Okay.
Sometimes I'll see a face. Sometimes I have a knowing. Sometimes I'll just write them down. This name, that need. Sometimes I'll hear a birthday, put a birthday down, anniversary, put an anniversary. I'm just writing stuff down that I got because I prayed enough in tongues to get that breakthrough called revelation breakthrough.
Amen.
Yeah. Revelation gifts are tied to that revelation anointing of His Word. Boy, someone's going to catch that.
Yes.
Yes.
It's the same anointing. The same anointing that reveals the Word to you is the same anointing that will give you a word of knowledge, word of wisdom, and discerning of spirits.
Amen.
Same Holy Ghost.
Same Holy Ghost.
Woo! Glory. So get excited when God reveals the Word because you can tap into words of knowledge, words of wisdom, and discerning of spirits.
Yes.
Yeah. Hallelujah. Last but not least, go to Ephesians chapter 3, verse 1. Woo, come on, there's five things about how revelation comes. And five is what? Grace.
Grace.
Number five is grace. In Ephesians chapter 3, verse 1, for this cause I, Paul, the prisoner of Jesus Christ, for you Gentiles, if you've heard of the dispensation of the grace of God which was given to me for you, to you word, how that by revelation he made known unto me the mystery. As I wrote afore in a few words, what was that mystery? Christ in you, the hope of glory. That mystery was the fact that the church, you know, that Jesus is the groom and we're the bride. I mean, there's several. I can preach a whole message on what is the mystery. There's several mysteries. Hallelujah.
Yes.
Somebody missed. I want to do a research. Look up the word mystery every time it's mentioned in the Bible, and particularly in the New Testament. Go to the New Testament, look up the word mystery. And study it out. And you're going to be amazed. What a message. Woo, what a teaching will come to.
Jesus.
Amen. Then verse 4 said, whereby when you read, you may understand my knowledge of the mystery of Christ. Then verse 5, which in other ages was not made known unto the sons of men, as it is now revealed unto his holy apostles and prophets by the Spirit. Here's the key. Apostles and prophets. We're talking about seasoned apostles and seasoned prophets. Fivefold ministry prophets that are seasoned. Okay? God will cause the word to be unveiled by them. I believe that is why when I preach and teach, stuff comes alive to people. It's the prophetic apostolic anointing on my life. It's not Phil Rich. I had an apostle, and the most amazing thing about this apostle, Apostle Fred Pine, was that when I would talk to him, if I ask him a question, I would ask a question about the word. And then just within seconds, his eyes would light up. And he, I remember one night he taught me all night long. I was traveling with him to do missions in Mexico. He had a tremendous mission ministry in Mexico. And I was with him, and I was rooming with him, you know, to save on funds and money and stuff. And so we were rooming together. We both snored loud, so we just didn't really bother each other at all. So anyway, we were rooming together. And so late at night after one of the meetings, I asked him a question. And he sat up on the bed and looked at me, and all of a sudden, his eyes lit up. And for the next 8 hours, he unveiled the Word of God to me in a way I'd never seen before. And I sat there amazed, not sleepy at all. Isn't that wonderful?
Yes.
I could care less about time.
Yes.
I wanted to know what he knew. And later, that would happen throughout the 13, 14 years that I knew him.
Wow.
And I remember I talked to him. I was saying, you know, it's amazing what comes out of you. He said, Phil, can I give you a secret? I said, yes. He said, many times you'll ask me a question. He said, I don't know what in the world I'm going to say to you.
Yes.
I have no idea how to answer you. He said, something goes click inside my spirit. And when it goes click, the word just starts coming to me. Scriptures start coming to me. Revelation of stuff I didn't even realize I even knew starts coming out of me. He said, it's the apostolic.
Yes.
That you have triggered in
yes.
my life.
Yes.
Isn't that wonderful?
Yes.
Wow. Things that have been hidden by religion and tradition through the apostles and prophets, the word will be unveiled. I want to say this so there's not a misunderstanding. The apostles and prophets are not to reveal something to you that's never been in the word. Right. It's just stuff that we haven't seen in the word.
Yes.
Because of religion and tradition, we're blinded to it. And revelation is progressive. See, the path of the righteous is as a shining light that shines more and more to the perfect day. Book of Proverbs. So it's progressive. It builds. Revelation builds on revelation. Like a building. Right? And so the apostles and prophets, what they're going to do is they're going to unveil things that we haven't seen. And when it's unveiled, get this, when it's revealed, through revelation comes manifestation. Through revelation comes motivation. Isn't that wonderful?
Yeah.
Many, many years ago, if you remember, right before, if you know anything about church history, there was a time when we understood about salvation, but not the infilling of the Holy Spirit. Right before the turn of the century, in the 1800s, there were some people that started really studying the Word and praying and pressing in. And I believe God used some apostles and prophets back then as God started raising them up. And they unveiled some things in Scripture about tongues being for today. And before long, there was a breakout of people speaking in tongues that never spoke in tongues before. And then it just went wild, see. Then if you remember, in the 40s, 50s, and 60s, there were apostles and prophets that began to unveil healing for today. Physical healing. Before that time, the church was just sick, and they just died when they get sick.
Right.
But all of a sudden, there's tent meetings, and there's an outbreak of healing. And over 100, what they call healing evangelists, started just going all the way across America, and it hit the whole world, with healing, miracles, signs, and wonders. But they noticed that people would get healed and then get sick again. They would lose their healing. So here comes some apostles and prophets that started realizing we got to teach the word because healing comes from the word. And you can never keep your healing without a revelation of the word. So all of a sudden that came forth. And then you had people like the Copelands and the Hagans. Come on, somebody.
Yeah,
many, many others, right? Yeah. And so many others began to start rising up. A teaching ministry began to come. And they started unveiling the teaching of the Word of God, because I'm telling you, you get everything by the revelation of the Word. See? We didn't know that before. We thought the Holy Spirit would just heal whoever He wanted to. And if He didn't want to, you didn't get healed. And if you lost it, maybe because, you know, you really didn't get healed in the first place. And all of that is bogus now. We realize from the Word it doesn't say that. But we had to get the revelation of what the Word really said. Are you catching this?
Yes.
And so the Word coming by the apostles and prophets is changing everything for us. Yeah. Now I want to tell you, there's some things happening now that's being revealed right now about our inheritance and about the glory. Yeah. Amen. That we didn't know many years ago. There's a few folks that did. There's some things being revealed in this season about prosperity and how much God really wants to bless His people. That we really haven't seen before. And yet some of them who taught it have been called, you know, heretics and money grabbers and everything you can imagine, you know, shysters and the whole nine yards. And the Copelands are some of those that people have just spoke against, you know, to come against. And there's some people that I know that have tremendous anointing to break poverty and lack off your life. But Satan hates them.
Yes.
And the church is rejected. You know what happens when anything God unveils something new? First thing that happens is rejection before acceptance.
That's it.
People will reject the truth of God before they accept the truth of God.
Man.
So don't think that if God gives you a revelation, everybody's going to love you for it. You might be hated for it. People may reject you because of it.
Right?
Yes. And there's some powerful men, you know. I mean, there's a man that I watched on television. You know, he has this phrase, money cometh. Leroy Thompson?
Yes.
Is that him?
Yep.
And I'm going to tell you, you know, have you ever actually listened to the man? He gives scriptures. I mean, he's a powerful man of God. And he's actually right on. But Christians are hating him. They're saying he's wrong. They're saying he's way off. But actually, he's light years ahead of many folks. And he knows that actually we're supposed to take authority over finance. Boy, somebody will catch this. Now listen, everything was created by words. Somebody needs to hear this. Everything was created by words, even silver and gold.
Come on now.
And so.